then I'll give a little update on the talk I gave in November. We're looking at perilaric development post-TC and tropical cyclone weights using our remote network. And as motivation, in the past 5 to 7 years, there's been quite a bit of work looking at pre-existing barrier layers. So salinity-driven barrier layers have been shown to reduce entrainment of polar water from below the isothermal layer into the mixed layer. And this has feedback into TC maintenance and intensification. So it reduces the negative feedback. You get increased enthalpy flux, and therefore TC intensity can be sustained under these conditions. And so that's kind of looking at ocean state prior to a TC passage. Looking at TC weights, there's been many studies that have looked at the thermal and dynamic response in TC weights during the fourth stage. And most of these deal with SST cooling, mixed layer cooling, typically to ride a track, salt track, and also strong inertial or near inertial currents in weight as well. But there's been less attention given to the freshwater winds that occurs from precipitation during the fourth stage of the TC, and also how the salinity responds in the wake. And so questions I'm attempting to answer, or at least clarify, is how does this precipitation impact the upper ocean density structure during TC passage? And then also, what are the characteristics of these fields of the freshwater anomalies? What's their depth extent? How frequently do they occur? And what's the decay time scale? So quickly I'll go over defining what the barrier layer is. So this is a profile from the surface to 100 meter depth on the y-axis. And the upper x-axis is salinity in blue. And there are two lower x-axes, red is temperature and density is in black. And so the isopicolayer depth of the mixed layer is defined as a density increase of 0.1 kilograms per meter cubed from the 10 meter reference level. And so based on this profile, it put the isopicolayer on 18 meters. The isothermal layer depth is defined as a temperature decrease of a half degree Celsius from the 10 meter reference level. And that puts the isothermal layer at about 72 meters. So this would be a very large barrier layer extent of 50 meters. Most studies define barrier layer strength based upon this thickness, and 50 meters is a huge barrier layer. But the thickness doesn't tell you anything about what the density is doing between the layers. And so some studies have looked at using barrier layer potential energy as a way to quantify stratification into salinity, and also a little bit into temperature. It's a depth integral of the potential energy from the isothermal layer to the surface. And so you subtract PE mix is the integral using a constant rho. So you just average from the isothermal layer to the surface, the density, and then integrate. And then this equation here, you're just taking the profile density and integrating. And when you subtract, you get a positive value. So essentially, it's the amount of energy that it takes to fully mix this layer. So I've been using the Argo Float Network. These are free floats. There's about 3,800, I think, currently. And they're all around the world. And I'll talk a little bit about the sampling and quality control. So differences from the talk in November. I've subset the Argo floats based upon basin. So look at Central Pacific, Eastern Pacific, and Atlantic. N is the number of profiles I have in each. And I've listed some of the quality control that I've done right here. I went through this in the last talk, so I'll kind of skip over this a little bit. And another change I've made is I've looked at non-TC Argo pairs. And so I've taken, just to see how much background variability plays, and how much variability you can expect just in regular sampling using And so these pairs are consecutive profiles from the same loc that are not within 10 days of TC, plus or minus 10 days, or 500 kilometers from the Herdat 2 best track. And then I use the same sampling QC as the TC pairs. So there's a distance criteria of 50 kilometers. Vertical sampling has to be at least one every 10 meters in the upper 50 meters. That helps with the BLT integration and some other constraints as well. So just to take a look at the sampling in space and time, this axis here is the number of days after TC goes by, and this axis is the distance from the best track, and then the z-axis is just a count. And so you see a peak in the top temporal and spatial distribution here, 100 kilometers away from the best track, and anywhere from about 5 days, plus or minus. So we have the Atlantic, Eastern Pacific, and Central Pacific, and sampling is pretty similar, so not too worried about the sampling there. Also, artifacts typically sample every 10 days, but they don't have to. Some sample every 5 days, some can be remotely controlled, so they can sample a high frequency up to an hour. And I just wanted to check and make sure that the sampling between consecutive profiles was similar. And for the most part, it's typically true. So 10 days for the Atlantic, about 80% of the profiles are sampling 10 days. And then for the East Pack and Central Pack, 90% or more of the profiles are within 9 to 11 days. So I've taken these BLPE calculations and subtracted the post-TC profile minus the pre-TC profile to see how this equation is changing as TC goes by. The upper left panel here is the BLPE calculation, and it has some stats up there, the count, the number of cases, the mean, and then also the t-score. The right-hand side, upper right, is the barrier layer thickness, left bottom is isothermal layer depth, and right bottom is isothermal layer depth. And so all variables for the Atlantic Basin show a statistically significant increase in 95% level from pre-TC to post-TC ocean state. So essentially, your potential energy here is becoming more as the TC goes by, which is kind of counterintuitive. When the TC goes by, a strong forcing tends to induce a lot of mixing, and any pre-existing barrier layer gets eroded. I get explained more about that. So the largest mean BLP difference occurs in the Atlantic Basin compared to the L2, and it's about 135 joules per meter squared. That's fairly significant, considering the mean is about 750-800 joules per meter squared. And there are the changes in the BLPE and barrier layer thickness mirror the isothermal layer depth distribution, and there's not much of a change in the isothermal layer. And then also, the red line is the no TC cases for comparison. And there was no statistical significance for these cases as you would expect, but there's no forcing. So to take a look, a closer look at the Atlantic BLPE distribution, this was the upper left-hand figure from the previous slide. There's an increase and events here from 500 to 1,000 joules per meter squared in TC cases. And it made me wonder, is that a result of the salinity stratification argument, or is that a result of the isothermal layer deepening? Since the equation is an integral, if the depth changes, you're integrating through a larger depth. It could just be a result of the isothermal layer depth increasing as the storm goes by. And so, I decided to run the same calculations, except picking the minimum isothermal layer depth within the pairs, and so that hold, the isothermal layer depth holds constant, and it removes any of the changes that are due to a change in depth, and strictly is looking at the stratification. And you see quite a big change in the distribution. So the peak is a little narrower, remove this change to the 500 to 1,000 joules per meter squared things. And just so you can see the comparison, you can see there's quite a bit of a change here. So the increase in the isothermal layer depth for Atlantic TCs is resulting in this ELPD increase. And it's correlated at about 0.77. So a pretty strong correlation there. And there's a negligible impact from the near surface salinity change. So take a look at some of the composited Argo profiles. The top row here are profiles for the TC cases. The bottom row are for the non-TC cases. And then left column is temperature, middle column is salinity, and right column is n squared. And you see a nice signature in the cooling response as TC goes by. The bold line is the pre-TC profile, and the dashed line is the post-TC profile. So you get cooling of about a quarter degree here in the mean. And for salinity, you do see a freshening in the upper 60 meters, but the slope of this line isn't changing. So for salinity to really play a role in the stratification, you need to see the slope of this line change, and it really doesn't. And that's reflected in the n squared values here. So as you typically expect, TC goes by, the column is well mixed, and stratification is eroded. I'll also note here for the non-TC cases, there's a little bit of warming, so this is 10 days, typically about 10 days, and you do get a statistically significant seasonal signal from warming. To kind of contrast what we see in the Atlantic, I'll highlight the Central Pacific. So the Central Pacific didn't show any statistically significant increases in the BLPE for my initial runs, but when I looked at the composited profiles, the salinity profile here looks like it should be creating a stronger stratification here. We have a freshening near surface where the slope doesn't change, but the slope here changes pretty significantly. The temperature response is also unusual. So if there's not much of a cooling response in upper 30 meters, I think that's probably due to the isothermal layer depth in the Central Pacific being pretty deep. So you don't see a huge response. You actually see a larger response in the lower half of the layer depth here. And then, interestingly, there's also an increase in the stratification as TCs go by in the Central Pacific. And I think that's occurring, one, from the salinity here, but also this temperature change would produce this type of cloud as well. You're getting a stronger decrease in temperature. So I wanted to run some just quick sensitivity tests for the BLP calculation. How much does the depth play a role? How much does salinity play a role? And so a couple of quick plots here. The blue contour is the BLPE using a constant salinity profile, but changing the isothermal layer depth linearly. And so this is nonlinear in Z. The vertical lines here represent the mean isothermal layer depth in black, and then the 75th quartile and 25th quartile depths. And then the red circles are from this plot here. So the red circles, I used a constant 50 meter isothermal layer depth with a constant temperature profile, but then change the slope of the salinity. And so this high slope here is based upon the 75th quartile mean from the Argo flows, and then it just varied linearly with depth. And this is the changes you get. So you get a pretty significant increase here in the BLPE response from salinity as well. So a little discussion. The Atlantic Basin shows an increase in the BLPE after TC passage, but this is due to the increase in isothermal layer depth, not to the salinity change. Because that statistical significance went away when we used a constant isothermal layer value. Contrarily, the Central Pacific Basin has a statistically significant increase in BLPE only when we use the constant isothermal layer value. So that's coming from the changes in both temperature and salinity, not from the depth and integration. One caveat from this work, Argo has sampling that isn't great for looking at TCs, because you get essentially get one snapshot. You get a pre-TC look and a post-TC look. And so you could be missing the freshwater anomaly due to precipitation if the profile is taken 5, 6, 7 days after the passage, because you precipitation anomaly gets erodes quickly. So you have horizontal advection transporting the signal away from the track. You have vertical advection of high salinity water from below, and mixing, turbine mixing, and shear induced mixing from the near natural currents. So precipitation likely has a limited impact on subsequent TCs that may transverse lingering cold wave. And there's an undetermined impact of precipitation on upper ocean mixing and the cooling response during the fourth stage of the TC. And a little bit of a look at future and current work we've been looking at. I have a nice set of bladder observations from Judith Curry and Mark Bichard at the Community Institute of Ocean Sciences. And they have a glider that sampled roughly every hour or two for this 6-day period during Hurricane Gonzalo's passage near Bermuda. And this is just simply a plot of the salinity contour with depth on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. And you see a really nice surface freshening response due to precipitation here. And the salinity decreased by about 0.3. And so using some of this data, I'm working with Su Chen on running some idealized couple of points TC simulations of Gonzalo using an average temperature and salinity profile from these observations. This removes a lot of background ocean state variability, or at least I hope so. It can kind of obscure the signal. And then also, we're going to run some high-pass couple of simulations that include the background variability and control that has precipitation feedback onto the ocean, and then one without. And so from that, I'll look at how the SST responds to the precipitation forcing, and then if there's a corresponding change you would expect. And with that,
some way of subsetting TCs or maybe high precipitation TCs versus low precipitation TCs, possibly by translation speed, something like that. For example, we're not seeing a lot of salinity effects on the thermal structure, which is what we're most interested in. But maybe for something in an extreme case of niche that, you know, that hung out and rained forever. Maybe there is. Do we have an updated subset for likely extreme rain rate storms?
Potentially. I mean, in the Atlantic, I have over 500 profiles, and it's across 14 years, so from 2000 to 2014. So we miss out on a niche. So
right. Maybe there's other slow rain storms.
Right.
Some of them would not drop each and a half rain.
But even with Gonzalo, at this point, the storm is recurving and moving pretty quickly, and you still see pretty nice salinity response, even though it's confined to pretty much plus or minus 1 day here.
Yeah,
so that's why the market is missing out on most of this.
Yeah, right, it's eroded very quickly. That's why I'm thinking it's possible that very high rainfall storms may not erode as quickly or leave their signature.
And you get a little give and take with a strong, slow-moving storm. You might dump more precipitation on the area, but you're also increasing the time and amount of mixing that's occurring. And that typically, if you look at satellite retrievals of cold wakes, a lot of times you see a salty wake because the subsurface salinity max gets mixed with the surface. So it kind of obscures the precipitation. of one patient in Fargo.
So just another comment in terms of, you know, validating the work that you're looking at. Have you considered looking at aircraft deployed XCV data? HRD is on a number of field deployments. And I'm not sure if they have a response in the upper ocean that they're looking for, for example, but you might want to look at some of those data sets as well.
Right. Yeah, I've looked at a few of those for the Zalambilio and also for Isaac. For Isaac, there's a lot going on. It's crossing the wind current, and so you have a lot of factors playing a role there. But yes, so that, certainly for Gonzalo, which is where we're trying to go with the modeling aspect, I'll need to look into some of those data sets to supplement the wider data.
So John, the differences in temperature and salinity that you showed, I think, for the Atlantic, they're so small, and I was wondering if those differences are larger than the observational errors of the profiler.
Okay. Certainly, salinity is pretty small. The temperature has about a quarter degree change at the upper surface layer. I think some of that uncertainty is averaged out because we're using it very large sample size. There's over 500 profiles. There's definitely a clear signal in the temperature. Salinity gets obscured a little bit because, like I said, you have competing processes that want to either increase the salinity at the surface from mixing or decrease it from decreasing. And so that signal is harder to see. And there might not be a signal. At least statistically, there isn't a signal for the Atlantic because of, I think, the sampling constraints. But the sample size should take care of some of that uncertainty. And I should probably put those on the plots next time I show the uncertainty margin there.